I remember the first time I saw you on Missy's MTV Cribs episode.
By the pool.
Yep.
Playing the guitar.
Playing the guitar. Mm-hmm. And I was like, ooh, who is that?
Yep. I feel like she's one of the most underrated artists, an underappreciated artist ever.
And it's okay, though.
It's not.
Yeah, it is okay.
Put some respect on my mom's name.
Brandy or Jasmine Sullivan.
We sound crazy.
Shake it, shake it, shake it, shake it. Shake it.
Welcome to another week of We Sound Crazy. Your boy, Billionaire, is in the building.
Claude Kelly is in the building.
What's up? Chuck Harmony is in the building.
Bacon from Macon is here, and I'm present and glad to be here.
But you know, who's in this building, though. Like, in this, we still in the ATL, right?
Listen, yeah, we're in the ATL.
And I have an amazing singer, songwriter, producer. But hold on, I gotta just pull out this situation that just got freshly signed. Yeah. Right here. Freshly signed. This masterpiece.
The Southern Hummingbird. Yeah. The Southern Hummingbird herself.
It's mine. Oh yes.
The Southern Hummingbird.
Man. Oh,
Tweet.
Hey.
It's in the building. Make some noise.
Yes, I am. I'm here. Hey, y'all.
So just so you know, like when we started the podcast, right, we made a list of like dream guests.
It's almost in the whole episode like the whole episode. Y'all can say what y'all want. I got mine. Yeah. Hope you got yours.
Now, when we first started the podcast, like now this is our fourth season. You were at the top of our list of guests. We've been trying to get you.
Really?
Yeah, man.
Yep.
Me?
We are Tweet fans.
Oh, thank you.
And supporters in this building.
Thank you so much. Yeah,
it's an honor to have you.
It's an honor to be here. Thank you so much.
So many questions. So many things to talk about.
Okay, let's go.
Look, she's ready. Are you ready?
Uh-huh.
All right. Bill, since you're clutching the vinyl, you know what I'm saying? Go ahead, bro.
This is mine. I want to go back to a little bit of the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of people think the journey started here.
No.
It did not.
Mm-hmm.
Can we go back to Rochester?
Rochester, New York, born and raised. We're going to skip.
Come on, New York.
I went to a school of the arts, which is a performing arts school. Mm-hmm. Then I joined this gospel group. And then,
what's the name of that group?
Greater Love. It was myself and two other young ladies. You know, Wendy Henderson Wyatt. Have you heard of her? She's out now.
Yeah, we used
to be her background singers.
Okay.
And then we did that. We all went to school together. And then Jodeci came to Rochester to do that, the show, the after party, that last album.
Mm-hmm.
And Devontae was looking for a girl to audition to be in a girl group. And I got the part. And while
in
I
Rochester,
was in Rochester,
at
they
the
came.
Show?
Yep.
Wait a minute.
Crazy.
Freaking you,
so
all
you
of that.
So you go to the show?
No. That was the name of Jodeci's album. It was show.
I thought you said they came to the tour.
No, they were living there, actually doing their album. And Devontae was looking for someone for this group, Sugar.
Gotcha.
And I auditioned and I became part of Sugar.
Wow.
So, yeah. So it starts there. Jodeci came, Devontae rented out a whole like studio building and he had all of his artists there, which was Tim and Missy, Genuine, Playa. He had like 13 artists.
Stevie J was there. He told me he used to be in the basement.
Mm-hmm.
Too.
Stevie J?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Stevie told me. I had no idea.
I didn't know about
when
that.
When Missy had her the wax unveiling in Vegas like a year or so ago, Stevie J, somehow we ended up hanging for 3 hours waiting on the unveiling.
Yeah.
And during that time, he started talking about the basement days. And he said he was roommates with Genuine, Elgin.
Mm-hmm. What?
Wow.
Yeah. So that's
who were you roommates with?
I stayed with Sugar. Sugar. Okay. We had our own apartment. Playa had their own apartment, so it was like
that's crazy.
Yo, that's
that's a lot of R&B history in one house.
Yeah,
one
it house. Is. And I mean, even to the point we went to, I think it was 1989. They had this huge tour. It was Biggie. It was Bad Boy. It was what's Tretching Them?
Naughty
by Nature. Mary J. Blige. Mm-hmm. We opened that whole tour. So I've been around for a minute. Yeah.
She's like, don't sleep.
Crazy.
I've been around for a minute.
So working with Devontae, how was it? Because again, I've heard stories from a number of friends. How was your experience?
Working in a studio, it was it was great to be around him because he's a genius, you know. Personally, it was ups and downs. You know, he was really, really hell-bent on us being serious about our craft. You know what I mean? Sometimes that was hard because we were young. We wanted to go out and party, but we couldn't do none of that. We had to stay in the studio 24/7.
He was strict.
What? Absolutely. And if you didn't come up with a song in that day, it was like we used to have meetings. Remember Martin had the meeting about his walkie-talkie or something got stolen, and he came with the dog. That was our meetings like that. Every Wednesday, Devontae had a dog called Skills, and he was a big dog like that, and he would sit at the head of the table, and we would talk about, like, music. Did you do a song today? Did you do a song today? And things like that. So he
was a big dog at the head of the table?
A stuffed dog.
Huh?
A stuffed dog or
no,
a real dog?
No, real dog.
A real dog, dude.
No. it was like Nino Brownish. You
that's
know what I mean?
Crazy.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, we went through a lot.
No pressure.
Mm-hmm. Anybody got bit with a dog?
No, Skills was cool. Okay. If he didn't know you, he would kind of go after you or whatever. But Skills was a cool dog.
So I want to walk this back. Okay, let me this. We're sitting at a table. Imagine us now. We're in a meeting.
Mm-hmm. Right.
There's a dog sitting in a chair.
Sitting right next to Devontae. Yeah.
So what did you learn? You just talked about the studio, but what did you learn from him that you were able to apply once you got to headed down toward doing that record?
Doing the record? He really made us sit in our talent. Mm-hmm. We weren't allowed to listen to anybody's music, watch any videos, none of like that. It wasn't a cult. I can appreciate it now because had I been influenced by anything else, my sound might have been a little different than what you hear.
Yeah,
you understand what I'm saying?
So it worked.
It worked.
So you don't regret it then?
No, I don't regret it. I don't regret anything I do because it was all either a learning experience or something like that.
Yeah.
So y'all missed a whole era of videos and albums.
We used to sneak and watch now.
Okay.
Yeah, when Missy left and when Rain came out, we snuck and watched that video, but we got in trouble because he found out.
Mm. Wait a minute. Yeah. So hold on. So Missy leaves and does her thing, and Rain comes out. Yeah, you still and couldn't watch videos.
No, we couldn't. We couldn't be inspired by anything else.
So like, you lost contact with Missy when she
for a little while. Yeah, for a little while, and then that's when we started moving around, and he signed us to different labels, and then we never put an album out. We recorded an album like 7 times, the same album.
Really?
Because he wouldn't turn it in, and then they would lose the reels. Back then, it was reels. But we used to get signed to different record labels, and that's what. From we lived in Charlotte, we lived in New York City, Jersey, L.A. We was all over the place.
Wow. So who was he the primary? Was Devontae the primary producer?
Yeah.
For the group.
Mm-hmm.
Any other writers in the camp that you?
We used to write. He used to write too. And Missy wrote a couple of songs for us, and Dalvin did too.
Wow.
I want to hear it all.
It's dope. Ask my daughter, oh my God, if we put those records out right now, it'd be hitting.
Really?
Serious.
Damn. Is there a chance that you can?
We tried. We talked about it, and we're still kind of seeing if we can. Mm. But I don't think it would be with Devontae because he's busy or he don't want to do it or, you know, it's excuses. But we can get somebody else to reproduce. He's not mad at that. We talked about that. But those songs are classics already, and they're not even out.
Wow.
I happen to know someone who has the masters.
You know what? Somebody do have some masters.
Yeah.
You do?
I know someone.
Red Ant.
He's probably watching right now. Probably watching right now. But we'll talk offline. But I know somebody who actually has some of those basement masters.
Yeah.
Including
Sugar. Yeah. Not only us, but
Sugar.
Not only us, though. Missy. All of the groups that were in there, we have a lot of drives or reels that are somewhere. You're like Def Jam might have them, or you know they're just lost songs.
There's a vault of them.
There's a lot of them.
Or my friend's garage.
Are you serious?
Yeah, very serious. He's watching now. Hi. We'll call you. We'll call you.
Because the streets want to hear the unreleased music.
Absolutely.
I'm serious. Them songs, even. Just the basement stuff, not just my group, but the whole crew in itself. Had he made that happen, it was going to be like the new Motown.
That's what it sounds like.
Yeah.
So what happened?
Yeah, what happened?
He wanted either everybody get signed or you get nobody. He was taking too long. for people, for artists. They were ready to get signed and get out there. It was just taking a little too long, so people started leaving. And that's what happened.
Mm-hmm. Dang. We sound crazy. Mississippi putting it down. I'm the hottest round. I told
y'all, y'all can stop me now. Listen to me now. I'm less than 20. Missy happened to call me out of the blue because she was doing Missy So Addictive, whatever, that album.
Wait a minute. Hold on. So, because that's quite some time, though.
Absolutely.
Because So Addictive is her third album.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So she leaves, y'all sneaking, y'all see the Rain video, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, get in trouble for seeing that. Mm-hmm. People are pairing off a little by little.
Yeah.
She puts out a whole nother album after that.
But Missy was in the group then too. Yeah. She was right. a sister, right.
Yeah. She had left Sister at the end of, before she left the basement, she was gone. That's when Buffy called her to do Regina, what's her name?
Gina Thompson.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And she was at.
She's like, deuce
it. I'm not coming back.
So what happened? So what was going on with you, with the group, or and just you by yourself between that time and So Addicted?
Well, homeless. Life. Pretty life. Much. No, life. Mm. Came back home to try to take care of my daughter, and I couldn't find a job. That's when I really started drinking a lot, started smoking cigarettes, like all of that. Mm-hmm. And that's what happened. And then Missy called me. I was living in Panama City, Florida, with my parents. Mm. And she called out of the blue. And that's when I was like really drinking, driving to the beach and just sitting by the water like, what am I doing? You know mm-hmm. what I mean? What's going on with my life? Mm-hmm. And she called and said, I need you to do background vocals. Whatever, Missy. And then I came here to Atlanta mm-hmm. and was living with my cousins for a while. And she called and said, I got a limo outside.
Wow.
To pick you up. And that's when I went to LA and I never came back.
That's crazy.
Then as I was out there, she heard me singing Motel in a Room in one of the
Motel's my jam.
that's that one.
You showed your emotions just the previous night.
In one of the studio rooms, she didn't know I could play the guitar either. Mm. So she overheard. She was like, what was you doing up there? I was like, nothing, just chilling. She's like, you was playing something, stop playing. So I played her Motel, and she took me. We flew maybe 3 days later or something like that. Timeline, I can't remember quite. And then she took me to New York for Sylvia Rome. I got signed to Elektra like that. And
just
I was
like that?
Just like that.
What was that first meeting with Sylvia like?
I played Motel and smoking cigarettes, and she was like.
In person?
Yeah, live with the guitar by myself.
That's how you do it.
Yeah, and she was like, oh, come on. She was so excited. Come on, we got, when you want to start doing your album? I was like, right now.
Oh.
That was it.
That's crazy.
I remember nothing.
I remember the first time I saw you on Missy's MTV Cribs episode.
By the pool.
Yep.
Playing the guitar.
Playing the guitar. Mm-hmm. And I was like, ooh, who is that?
Yep. Basketball.
And then that was what, like 01?
Yeah.
Yep.
02, Oops, Oh My Hits.
Yep.
And we're like, yo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But see, like, the timeline. See, I left the group in 99, went back home, tried to get a job. Missy called. My album was out in 2002. And between there, I was doing all of the stuff with Missy, from her backgrounds mm-hmm. to Madonna. You know, I started doing a whole lot of stuff.
You see how she just slid that? Mm-hmm. She's like, receipts.
You know what I'm saying? Madonna.
No, we,
so take me. I know we moving fast. And
yeah, we are. I'm skipping.
But I want to go back to that time when life was happening. Like, what did you learn at that point that prepared you for this meteoric success that you were about to have?
I wasn't prepared because mm-hmm. I thought it was over once I left. Coming from Rochester, you would never, you know, known any artist to be there. Mm. Jodeci to be in Rochester was everything for everybody. You know, it's a small town in Rochester. Yeah. So for me to even be a part of Sugar, just be around them, I was just blessed. You know what I mean? And then when it stopped, I thought it stopped. But God had a different plan. Mm. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
It wasn't up to him, Devontae, or that situation to get me where I am today. It helped. It was, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But God had the last say.
Have you seen Devontae recently?
I seen him at, what was that? Lovers and Friends. Year before last. In Vegas.
What'd he say?
What's up, Tweet? It was cool. It's all love. You know what I mean? Oh, okay. I'm not harboring nothing.
That's a lot of history, though.
It is so much history.
Man.
Yeah. You saw my face.
That could be a documentary.
Straight up.
It is really good.
It's a doc.
Because you're talking about a whole building of people that changed the sound of American
literally,
music.
Yeah. Literally changed.
I'm not saying R&B. I'm not saying.
Yeah.
I'm talking about American music.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Right.
On down.
Right.
Like how people write, how they sing, how they record. Mm-hmm. You include, I'm talking about all of y'all. Like it's a lot of influence there.
But it makes me wonder though, just because it was so much potential there, but what blocked it? Because some of the stories I've heard.
Mm-hmm. Spill the tea, Phil.
I'm just saying, some of the stories I've heard from different people, it just made it sound like it was very toxic at times.
It definitely was. Mm. When you said concentration camp, it was definitely that. Mm. You know what I mean? But we was just kids. As long as we can get in the studio and we could sing, that's what we felt like. That's what the machine was. Not knowing that we were silently suffering, you know, and crying behind closed doors, or afraid to tell our families that we didn't eat for 3 months. Or
3 months?
Jesus.
We have stories.
Wow. I heard there's a lot of mental, emotional, physical abuse, allegedly.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Happening during that time.
We have a lot of stories.
That's dark, though.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
That's
like
why
this.
It didn't work. I wonder why it didn't work.
I said, what was Stevie J and Genuine as roommates? Like, that's why I'm like, Stevie. what was that? Like, you know what I mean? Like,
tell that story.
Stevie was like. And because Stevie J became really tight with Dalvin, mm-hmm. so he used to be with him a lot after a while.
Yeah.
So it was G by itself, or G and, what's his name, Armani or something like that. Yeah.
What you remember about young Timberland?
Tim would never drink or smoke. He had a room down in the basement, and that's all he did was music. He'll come up, and we'd be goofing off, drinking our whatever, or partying. He'd be all looking at us, like shaking his head, like, what y'all doing? Like, you know what I mean? Y'all should be focused. Yeah, focused. I mean, completely. Vision completely brain. Focused. Yeah. Yeah.
So what was that first meeting like? Like, once you got with Missy and then you reunited with Tim, like, what was that first meeting like?
Well, I was already out there doing background vocals, you know, for Missy's album, and Tim was there. They, what we had, the studios in LA, they had rented out the whole studio, so I could see them all the time. He was excited that I was back in the family in the fold.
Yeah.
And oops. I can't even remember. I don't even think that was the first track I wrote Oops to. But it was Missy. They used to give CDs. Tim used to give Missy CDs with tracks on it to see what song she wanted. We was riding in the car and that came on. I said, well, I got something for that. And then sung it, and we did it that night. We recorded it.
Oops, there goes my shirt up over my head. Oh, my.
And Tim heard it. Tim was like, man. You know, Tim, he gets excited. But he was excited.
It's a hit.
It's a hit. Everybody went crazy. I was like, what are y'all talking about? I didn't see it.
So you didn't know?
I wanted Smoking Cigarettes My Place. Like,
So this is a topic I want to address. Because Oops was the perfect first single.
Yeah.
Because it did what it did.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, to your point, there were so many songs that were more organic.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That painted a different picture of who you were as an artist.
As an artist. Mm-hmm.
That I feel like, unless you were really listening, got overshadowed by the commercial explosion of Oops.
Mm-hmm.
When you start to dig in, it was so much more
soulful,
quartet, neo soul, poetry, gospel. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's all baked in there.
Yeah.
And I always wondered how you felt about that. I wonder how you felt about. Did you, as much as I know you love the first single, do you feel like it misrepresented the rest of the album?
It kind of, sort of, because a lot of people thought the album would be hip hop.
Right.
You know what I mean? Right. But we had a follow up. I hate that was the second single, because Smoking Cigarettes, we went to Canada and shot the whole video. Lil X did it. Mm. All of that. We had the Truth commercial ads in it. It was, we was about to, you know, put it out there. Somehow, somebody in the label or somebody, powers that be, said, nah, we good. I still ain't found out who did that move, that chess move.
Because smoking cigarettes is that
that's
one.
Right.
Newport wears some marble sailor
lights. But then check this out. Call Me was a part of the Verizon commercial, so I really didn't have to put that out as a single.
Right.
So I was like, we can have that out and nobody listened to me, and then that was that for me.
Since then, that song has literally become like a cult classic. Like
smoking cigarettes?
Everybody knows the words to that record.
Yeah, absolutely.
Newport Sailing Winston Sailor. Marvel.
I still remember our first kiss. Oh, I'm nervous and trembling. Smoking cigarettes at night.
Smoking out, you got to smoke about a pack a night. That's what the lyrics say.
That's a true story too.
Okay, I'm putting the co-host on blast. Favorite song from this masterpiece.
Okay,
I already got mine.
It changes a lot.
I got it. Mine changes too, but I'm gonna go with it. Changes
a lot. Always will.
And I hope they both. By the way, Tweed's on tour right now.
Yeah,
touring the Southern Hummingbird. Go to her website right here on the screen below. But I hope my songs are in the set list.
Okay, which one?
It changes a lot. But my favorite today. First thing comes to mind is, if I had your back, I wouldn't complain at all.
Yeah.
That one's nuts.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Poetry.
Always Will for me.
I love that one too.
Always Will.
Yeah.
Hotels for me.
Really? Mm-hmm. Wow.
I'm a bit torn because it's complain, but beautiful.
Beautiful. Okay.
But there's also My Place too.
Mm-hmm. Oh. Man.
It was one song, everybody. Just one.
but it's a no skip album.
No skip.
Yeah.
So all of these songs in your set list that we just referenced.
Yeah.
Huh? Which one is your favorite to sing?
It varies like a day to day. My Place is, I love My Place. I love smoking cigarettes too because I take it to church at the end sometimes. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm quartet. So I have to, you know, quartet it up a little bit. But one of my favorites, I think Missy hated this song when she first heard it. Not hated, but she was like, what? I don't understand it. But then she heard it and she was like, oh, that's dope. Drunk. That's
drunk
one of my
dope.
Favorites. Yeah. Yeah. It reminds me of like Prince. It's like Prince. Yeah. Inspired.
Definitely.
Yeah.
So you had Smoking Cigarettes and like what was the other songs you had before the actual deal? Before how Motel. Many songs did you have in the can?
It was Motel, Smoking Cigarettes, My Place, Always Will.
Jeez.
Yeah. The first initial two was Motel and Smoking Cigarettes.
So when you were in the, like literally creating Smoking Cigarettes, I want to go back to that place. Like, where were you? What was going on?
What's that story?
I actually was dating this guy for like 8 years and I saw one of my best friends coming down the stairs while I was going in our apartment. And he ended up leaving for the night or something. He didn't come home. So I was sitting on the patio and I just went to the store. Got me some cigarettes and just started smoking cigarettes, waiting on him to come home. It's for real. Yeah.
She's like, I was really doing that.
Yeah, I was really doing that. Yeah. Yeah, I was really in love with him, too.
That resonated with so many.
Yeah.
Not just women.
And we thank him for that. I mean.
I thank him for that.
I hate to be that person. But again, I thank him for not coming because, again, we got some greatness.
Yeah.
And I hate the benefit off of the pain that you were dealing with that time. But damn, that's such a great song.
Yeah, thank
again,
you.
On this album, that I got something. Look at this.
I'm going to tell you my personal connection to this album and to you. So I graduated from Berkeley in 2002. And.
Shout out to Berkeley.
Shout out to Berkeley.
I love Berkeley.
but when I was there, everyone was trying to figure out what they were going to do with their life. Stephanie Fisher.
That's my girl. Hey,
and Suki.
Suki. That was my sister.
Left and ended up singing background for you.
Wow.
So I graduated and came back to New York. Before I had ever written a song or anything, I didn't know, but I was just trying to figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
And I called Steffi and I was like, yo, can I just hang with you? Uh-huh. You probably don't remember this, but I literally sat in y'all's rehearsal at SIR for about 2 weeks.
In New York.
When you were working out with Nissan and everyone, the band, to go on tour. So I literally experienced Southern Hummingbird coming to life.
Wow.
I was just sitting back like, yo. This is the kind of shit I want to be doing.
Right.
And that was when I started like really discover that I was a songwriter,
mm-hmm.
and that I could like get into studios in New York was literally from sitting there and just being inspired.
Oh wow!
By those rehearsals.
Really?
So.
Wow.
That's crazy.
Thank you. It's super crazy. No, like literally, that album has a personal meaning to me because I loved the album before I heard it. Mm-hmm. I mean, before I met you all personally, but to hear it being built. Mm-hmm. And then also, as you, if you don't know, Tweet is a live performer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Is a whole nother level of excellence and crazy. Thank you. Getting able to hear the songs and see it come to life. Mm-hmm. And then also just watch it evolve throughout the years.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, wow.
How does
that take you back?
I'm about to cry, man.
Thank you. I'm like,
I mean, when, there's very few albums that I consider like, in like classics.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's like a Marvin Gaye, What's Going On.
Are you serious?
Yes.
That is a classic, classic. Full Moon classic.
Yes.
Classic.
I dare anybody to challenge it too out here.
I dare anybody to challenge it.
On any platform.
Oh my God.
I remember it was me and another friend of mine when we were like, tweet. And everybody was, you know, respectfully on Ashanti, which, you know, mm-hmm. she was hot at the time. Mm-hmm. We were like, no.
No.
This is the album that y'all need to be listening to. Mm-hmm. And I remember just over the years, like even when I went into college, it just, for some reason, like that album just really, in like a lot of circles, musician circles, singer circles, that album really kind of just took off, like even years after that record came out. And it's just,
look
it's
at Phil.
This day
thank you.
Phil over studying the cover like he had never seen it before.
I never thought it would do that.
Really?
I was just releasing. I had like years of pent up anger, you know, of not being able to fulfill the assignment of being in Sugar. You know, I just felt like a failure, but to be able to do my album and to sit there and create it, I wasn't thinking, oh, this is going to be a classic. Mm-hmm. I was just releasing. It was almost like going to see a therapist. It was therapy for me. Mm-hmm. So to hear this is like, wow.
That's probably why it's so great, is that if you knew, if you were thinking that way, you wouldn't have the same honesty. It just connects.
Yeah.
Wow. It just connects.
Thank
Do you hear some of your musical influences on the album?
I'm more quartet, so not so much on this album, but Charlene, definitely quartet. Quartet. I do hear Marvin Gaye a little bit on that one, and then like Prince on the drunk song, but yeah.
You know, when I think about you and your artistry, one of the things that come to mind, even before this record, was you mentioned doing backgrounds for Missy Elliott. Mm-hmm. Your backgrounds are like signature, some of the best. I want to understand, because again, I'm working on my album right now. Like, where do I start? Like, how do I get that sound? Like, when I think about some of the backgrounds, like on Take Away with Missy and some of these other records, like, how does that happen? Like, what do you do when you go in? Like, what do you hear? What do you start? Like, is it 12-part harmony, 16 stacks? What are you doing?
First of all, I don't like to stack my vocals because it takes away the essence of what the voice is. Because if you stack it, it just takes it away. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I just start with the whatever note and then I just build. Sometimes I hear like piano notes that would be a voice. Mm-hmm. Like Missy calls it, like some of my background vocals are really leads, but harmonized. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. It's just, that's just how I started doing it.
So you don't
it wasn't
double
on
any
purpose.
Of those lines?
No.
So each harmony is just one note. Mm-hmm. And then Tweet be running in harmony. Yep. like seriously, guys, like what the fuck?
Yeah, and I record dry. I don't like reverb or nothing like that. I really want to hear my voice.
Yeah. Mm. Damn.
Yeah.
You said Takeaway. Mm. I've two things. First of all, your ad-libs on Takeaway are nuts.
Thank you.
Always wondered, there's two versions of Takeaway.
It's Mila.
There's the Mila version and the Tweet version.
I love everything about you.
Takeaway.
Yeah.
You go to blind on you.
I do love Mila, but your version is the definitive version.
Aw. Thank you.
What happened there?
That was something I don't know. All I know is Missy was like, come in. I think Mila couldn't do it or couldn't fulfill. I don't know. Don't get me the line. Mm. But she said, come in, just do the ad-libs over. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did.
You did them.
Thank you.
They got done.
So speaking of misdemeanor, a friend of both of us, like that's VA, two up, two down, 757. Y'all know what it is. But Missy is my sister, and I know she's your sister as well. Yeah. Tell us a fond memory or a funny story of working with Missy or recording with Missy. Like, what's a dope memory?
Oh my God, let me think. Missy is such a comedian. Like, she's always cracking jokes. She know how to jones on you. Like, it's just all of that. People don't see that part of her. She's hilarious. Let me see, it's so many. Some that I can't even name because, oh my God. Oh, I don't know, it's so many. Let me think, I'm gonna come back. Can I come back to that? Let me think. Yeah, it has been a lot, yeah.
Now, the first album is a classic, but that ain't it.
No. Mm, gosh.
Because that second album, the next album, It's Me Again. First of all, Turn the Lights.
Kwame. Shout out to Kwame. Turn the lights up. I hate that I'm the only one to hear this.
Don't be mad, vocally challenged.
I do. I'm vocally challenged. The AI's been pitching.
You too can sing like
AI. AI and auto-tune. I got it.
For four easy payments. Nah, but that album is that's what I'm saying. Like, there's no misses in the catalog, but Taxi.
Ooh. Taxi. Ooh.
Yeah.
With the Taxi sample.
Yeah.
See, you gotta really know some shit about TV and that one. Mm-hmm. There's just a warmth.
Yeah.
Taxi.
I had to have that sample in there, and because he turned down everybody from Tim to whoever. I'm the only person ever that he gave clearance to. But he owns the record, okay?
He owns
that record. He was like, okay, I'll let you use it, but come on.
But give it all to me.
Yeah, I get it all. And I don't mind, because that song is everything.
Yes.
That song is everything.
I love it.
That's a record.
Yeah, we created that soundcheck. Soundcheck, usually with the guys, that's when we come up with a lot of our little grooves and stuff. Yeah, because we playing around. Oh, no, Craig Brockman.
Insane.
Yeah.
Craig.
So,
Craig.
So he played it, Taxi, in one of our rehearsals. And I was like, we need to do something with that. I came home and they sent it and I wrote it. And I was like, I can't sing about nothing else other than a taxi.
Yeah. Right.
Mm-hmm. What? It would sound crazy if I didn't say Taxi. And I wanted it to be simple, and that's what I did.
Crazy.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
You a writer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I started doing poetry. That's how I started writing songs.
Okay.
In middle school, elementary or something like that. Mm-hmm. I was in like an English class when I learned that stuff rhymes. Mm-hmm. I remember being a little girl like, oh, I could write things like that and it has to rhyme. Like I was like that. Mm-hmm. So I started writing poems. And then in high school, I wrote my first song. It was about Ralph Tresvant.
You wrote a song about Ralph?
I sure did. It's cheesy, but it was called Dreamer for Your Love, because I loved New Edition, straight super fan. And he was my favorite, so I wrote the song. It actually started off as a poem, and the girl in my music class, she was a jazz major, and she made it into a song, and it was playing on our school radio. I can't find it.
Have you ever told him this?
No. I've said it in interviews before.
Okay.
But I don't think he knows.
Well, he knows now.
He knows now. He's living in Ralph Tresvant.
What? That would have been awesome.
But you ain't that deep yet. All right.
We got it.
No. Speaking of just the many songs outside of yourself that you've written.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm a huge Whitney Houston fan.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You did Things You Say
yes.
on the Just Whitney record.
Mm-hmm.
Just please tell us your experience
with
Whitney.
Oh my God. Okay. Actually, she got that song by mistake, but I'm blessed. Missy, again, sending CDs. So she sent Charlie Burrell and I recorded the song in Miami. So it got on a CD that Missy sent to Whitney. And at that time, we was living in Miami. Whitney was the neighbor to Missy. So we would see her all the time. She'd come up to the studio and chill with us all the time. So she got it and she called. She was like, tweet, that song is from God. I gotta record it. So she recorded the vocals in New York, right? I think with Gordon Chambers. Yeah.
Shout out Gordon Chambers.
Yeah. And so she had to do the bridge. I had to write a bridge. So she came to Miami. We in the studio. She brushed through it and she left. She don't. She's not. She gonna do a part now. Yeah. Is it? She, yeah, she's real fast. And but it was like everything. I still listen to. I have a song that we didn't put on the second album of mine.
Yeah, okay, yours.
It's called Cool Breeze. Oh my God.
Is that the song you posted on Instagram?
They made me take that down too.
Who?
Whitney people don't play now. You're going to have to take that on down or talk to our lawyers.
Also, Whitney's people made you take it down. Was it her version of it?
It was her. It's a duet between me and her. Her and I. And I didn't put her whole voice on it, but a little bit of it.
So what you're saying, hold on now. So there is a Whitney Houston tweet duet that exists in the world.
It was supposed to be on the second album.
We have not heard.
Mm-hmm. It was going to be on the second album.
Someone get Pat on the phone.
Call Pat. Somebody get Pat.
Call Pat.
But yeah, I have that. I listen to it a lot. But Things You Say means everything to me. Because that's Whitney Houston.
It's Whitney
I would
Houston.
Have never, ever thought.
The Whitney Houston.
And that was so different.
The Whitney Houston.
That was
I
so
wrote
different
a song.
For her.
It was different.
For yeah.
Things you say. Things you say.
Yeah, but
so Whitney Houston, Madonna, you said earlier.
Yeah,
she humbly dropped that earlier in the conversation.
I am on some backgrounds for what American Me, I think it is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Who else? Because the writing credits are deep too.
Karen Clark. What's the song? I wrote a song on.
Simply moving
Can.
On, moving higher on. Ground, or
no.
Only Call on Jesus?
That,
only Call on Jesus.
Yeah.
On her second
that's
album.
That's me. Second Missy wrote that and
Lord.
I did the, yeah.
Man. That's my jam now.
My Love Is Like, Whoa, I did the bridge on that. Maya.
So Gone.
So Gone, I wrote the chorus for that.
Tell me this.
That's
was
a
so
Sugar
gone,
song.
Now, was, so was that originally your song? So Gone.
No, that was, Missy wrote that for Monica. But that's a Sugar hook. I took Sugar Hook.
Wait. So Gone Hook is a Sugar, so from back girl group days, Sugar?
That's a Sugar Hook.
Whoa. You make me feel.
Yeah, I wrote that. We was in the studio with Jelly Roll. It's a producer outside in L.A. Kin to the Gap Band. He's the Gap Band people. Mm-hmm. And we got it on video and everything. I actually put it up on my Instagram and I compared. I was like, see, I wrote... Because people don't really know.
Right.
So let me
that's
school you
nuts.
Real quick. You know?
School them.
Yeah, some people, you know, sorry. I got to let them know sometimes.
Like, whoa, So Gone.
Mm-hmm. My Love was like, whoa, I wanted that song real bad. Mm-hmm. But she gave it to Maya.
And but you wrote the bridge on it.
Mm-hmm.
So you still
I'm still on it, but I wanted that song so bad. I wanted it.
I can imagine that when you're hanging around Missy and Tim and them, you probably hear a lot of songs fly
past
your desk.
Yeah.
Are there any of the songs that you were like, yo, Missy, could I hop on that one real fast?
No, because she'd be calling. I mean, she'd be like, come on to it. You're hopping on this one. I don't really have to ask.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, there have been a few that I wanted and I didn't get.
My Love was like, whoa.
That was one of them. I think it was one she wrote for Beyonce that I'm on. What song is
Signs?
That? Is it Signs? Nah, is it Signs? I think it's Signs.
I love Signs.
Mm-hmm. Signs. Mm-hmm. I wanted that record. Yes, I wanted that. What? Yeah, I wanted that song.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's a catalog.
And you worked with Solange as well, right?
Yep, A Seat at the Table. Yeah, I'm backgrounding on like 7 of those records.
Mm-hmm. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
She's like, you better catch up.
Is it anybody you want to work with that you haven't worked with yet?
I wanted to do something with Andre 3000. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to. You know what I mean?
A crazy collab.
Let me see. Well, we already did Bilal. I love Bilal. I want to do like a Tammy Terrell and Marvin Gaye with Bilal. We talked about it years ago.
I can see that.
That's still on my bucket list before I get out of here. You know, I want to do that. Other than that, I don't know. I love me some BJ the Chicago Kid.
Mm-hmm.
I want to do a quartet album with, I got a song with Tim Rogers and the Fellas. We have a song.
Oh, like we just discovered Tim Rogers.
Really?
Just discovered.
It came up on YouTube. We were like,
singing. Yeah, singing.
You got a song with him?
Yeah, I have a song with him. Well, for my album. heard it, didn't you? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have. But I have a song that we put out maybe a year ago. Mm. You Were Made For Me. You heard
that? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Keep out here working.
I do.
So I got to tell y'all, I met Tweet years ago, but when I formally met her was at Essence Fest mm-hmm. some years ago.
Really?
I mm-hmm. literally, I was working at another company at that time, and I walked up to, I was like, one of my friends was like, yo, Tweet over in the VIP. And I was like, nigga, you lying, man. We're going over there. So we went over and I was like, oh, okay, let me get my, okay, this Tweet right here. You know what I mean? I had to get my whole situation right. Cause you know, at Essence, you know, your boy had a little extra Kool-Aid. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. So I was like, let me be focused. Cause I can't walk up just on some random, she's like, this nigga over here, he drunk, what are you talking about? So I walked up and I introduced myself and I told her I was an executive at a label. And I said, hey, whenever you're ready to do new music, mm-hmm. I'd love to, you know, do something with you. Let's figure it out. Mm-hmm. And that ended up being Charlene.
Yes.
Another great record.
I'm so grateful for you. Phil believed in me. He believed in the project and he did the videos. I had like, 13 videos.
We did a lot of videos. That's on me.
But I've never really had no one just really push the project like that. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. And he was like, no, we're making this happen.
That's Phil though.
And that's my favorite album. It's not that. Charlene is my favorite.
It's your favorite album.
Because mm-hmm. it's me. It's Charlene. That's why I call it a Charlene. Yeah. Mm. I grew up quartet and it's all quartet.
Yeah,
that album is. You ever heard it?
Yeah.
You heard
it? I have all your albums.
Don't get me. What?
What is it about quartet? What is it?
I grew up quartet. My mom and dad were quartet singers.
Okay.
So that's all I knew. I wasn't really into the choirs until like later on in life. Mm. I mean, we sung church choir songs, but. No, we was at them singings.
Yeah.
You know, we was at them singings.
Which quartet is your favorite?
Ooh, I have a lot. You have Harvey,
Lee Williams.
Mighty Clouds of Joy, mm-hmm. Gospel Keynotes. Mm-hmm. Like that's, I grew up old school. The Pilgrim Jubilees. Yeah. What's his name? Yeah, I'm very old school.
Jackson Southern is, yes.
The Tweet Quartet album will slap.
I want that.
So you're currently touring.
Yes.
I mean, you do a lot of shows. Yeah, you perform a lot.
Mm-hmm. I never really stopped after I came back. Because, you know, I took a hiatus, like 10 years.
And, okay, that's why a 10-year hiatus?
Because the label has switched. It was Elektra went to Atlantic. Mm-hmm. And that whole thing just wasn't good for me. They kind of shelved me, didn't believe in me. We were supposed to go to BET and release Turn the Lights Off in the video. And it was like, nah, we're not doing that. It was just a whole lot of... Because they really... The second album was done. I had a whole lot of Southern Hummingbird songs mm-hmm. on the air. But Atlantic is more like a hip hop label. Mm. So they sent me back in to re-record stuff. Like, what's the song? Missy did a couple of records on there. That, you know, it just wasn't the essence of. Mm-hmm. So I was like, I'm out of here. You know, and it was, nobody was talking to me. Nobody was telling me when nothing was coming out. It was just like a dud. Mm. So I left. Yep, nobody could find me.
You just went home?
No, I was in New York. I was just traveling, like, with my phone off, and people were worried and stuff. But I was like, I need a break. Mm-hmm. And then I was like, my soul wasn't. Mm-hmm. I was, you know, so I moved to Atlanta and started going to church. And I was like, I'm not doing music anymore. Until I met, what's his name? Gerald Busby. Mm-hmm. He wanted to sign. He was like, he believed in certain artists didn't get their chance. And that was the best deal I ever got besides Phil, because he didn't want anything back.
He just believed.
Mm-hmm. And then when we were going to release the first single off of that, I think it was Love Tweet, it was called, he passed away. And then that was it for that.
Man.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's...
But we eventually got those songs.
Yeah. Well, not some of them.
Yeah.
I think I did Tweet Tuesdays, if anybody, like.
Still got all those records in my phone.
Yeah. So So a lot of those were from Love Tweet. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Talk us about your faith, because I know your faith is very important to you, near and dear. What does your faith mean to you?
Everything. Like, I think if it wasn't for God and me taking that hiatus, I probably wouldn't, I didn't want to do music. But faith is what keeps me going, okay? Because I was very depressed, very out there. I was out there smoking and drinking, but until I decided to get my life right with Christ, is when everything turned around. So that's why it means a lot, because had I kept going on that road, I might not have been here. Yeah. So, yeah, God played a major role in turning me around. It might have felt like the bottom, but it wasn't. It was just a new lease on life, but it just was here. And he built me up from there.
Being the same business that Ooh. Also caused a lot of pain, how do you handle things differently now?
You know, I do tweet and I go home. I don't really, I'm not out in the clubs, you know, I don't want to be on Instagram. Like, I'm not that type of, I just learned to keep my peace by keeping my space. And that's how I deal with it. You know, I might scroll and laugh or, you know, do like that, but I'm not interested in, I'm from the old school, I'm not interested in people knowing my life like that.
Yeah.
You know, nah.
So that, and that
helps. That gives me peace. Yeah. I have to protect my peace because I wasn't here. You know, I was off. Smoking, until I was smoking 5-6 packs of cigarettes a day.
Five packs.
Ask my daughter, it was terrible drinking all day.
Really?
What?
What was it? Because looking at you now, you look younger than all of us.
Right.
So I'd love to know what you were drinking and smoking, because I may go get some after leaving. Because you look
five
amazing.
Tweet packs is not, it's not five regular packs.
It can't be.
I was never a Newport person, because Newports are just, ugh. I was a Marlboro ultralight girl. So, and cigarette smokers always say, them ain't cigarettes, that's just air you're smoking. So okay. That might be.
That might be why.
But yeah, but they were Marlboro ultralights.
Okay, I was a Newport smoker when I was a teenager, yeah.
I can't, they were too harsh.
I definitely tried a Newport or two in my high school.
Oh, when I was in high school.
They're intense.
They are, straight headache, I can't. That's,
I smoked a cigarette when I was 13 and I never again.
That's it, right?
Behind the movie theater.
I remember we all get our little smoking cigarettes confessions.
I too smoke.
I was 15 and I got in trouble for smoking cigarettes.
Yeah, I did. I smoked when I drank.
I want to talk about motherhood. Can we bring in a chair?
Yes.
Bring in a chair.
Oh, she's going to tell everything.
We sound crazy.
So, Tweet, we can't talk about not only your career, we're celebrating you all episode, but motherhood.
Yes.
I would be remiss if we did not acknowledge you as a mother, and your beautiful daughter has joined us, Shenice.
Yes. Hi. Yes.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. I'm honored to be here. Yeah. I watch you guys. I'm a fan.
You do?
Oh, Lord. I'll be turning up.
She really real deal. Shenice really like, she got her own situation.
Yeah, I'm a fan of her.
Yeah,
she's hilarious.
She's hilarious. Yes, she is.
We need to come on your show. Yeah.
Come on. Come on down.
I'm saying I sound scared. I'm like, we need to come on your show.
You don't need to be scared.
All right, okay.
So, Shenice, tell me this. Growing up, like, because again, Tweet was releasing music signed with Devontae in the 93-99 window, then went on to work with Missy and Electra. How was she as a mom during that time? What do you recall? Were you able to go out on the road? Were you at home with your grandmother? Where were you?
At church.
She's like, I was with the Lord.
I was with the Lord. Okay. No, but my mom, I remember the guy that she was talking about. He was around playing stepdad. I remember her taking me to the studio with her. So I was around. Devontae adopted me as his goddaughter when I was like 3 or 4. So I have memories of doing talent shows for Sugar and singing for Uncle G and just putting on shows for them. I don't have much memory of the Missy stuff because she didn't tell us. So I didn't know she went off and went on tour with Missy. I found out my mom was Tweet doing my algebra homework. And 106 in part was like, new joiner today, Tweet, so, Oops, Oh My. And I was like,
wow.
Yeah. Excuse me.
Wait a minute.
Hold on.
Wait.
Hold the fuck up.
Stop the damn presses.
Wow.
Breaking news.
Yeah.
You didn't know your mother was tweet.
No.
She was watching and doing algebra, and then saw.
You're watching One Season Park.
Yeah, that's how I found out. I experienced her at her lowest, the drinking and the, she would leave and my granddad had like a Cadillac or a Lincoln or something, like an old school Lincoln. She would leave, come back and be, you know, just distant. She was still present. She would help me with my homework and, you know, be in the house, but my mom wasn't present. Mm-hmm. So as a little girl, I'm just trying to figure out how to navigate what I see her going through, and I couldn't help her. The door would be closed sometimes, or sometimes I'll sing for her. Music was really something that carried us both through. Mm-hmm. Then she was like, I'm going to Atlanta. I got a job in Atlanta and I'll be back. And the next thing I heard was tweet, oops, oh my.
That's crazy.
Wow. Yeah, I never really told them.
Yeah, so what's this conversation? You're like, mom, hi, your tweet. What's good? What's good?
Yeah. It literally was like, what in the world? Mom, I just saw your video. And she was like, yeah, so... Because
I didn't know
doing,
it was
going
to pop off that quick like that. You mm-hmm. know, it really happened overnight.
Fast, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then our lives changed after that. It literally did. So,
yeah.
That's how I found out. I was literally doing algebra homework on the floor, just watching 106 in Park. And AJ's like, new joint of the day. Oops, I'm like, excuse me.
So, what happens when you go back to school the next day?
Like, school, she never took me out of public school. Mm-hmm. So, Panama City is even smaller than Rochester because mm-hmm. at this point we're in Florida. My grandparents left New York and we moved to Florida. So school was weird. It was very different because mm-hmm. clothes is different now. You know, I got my hair done a little bit more now. Yeah. I got a Louis bag. So it was kind of like, I wouldn't say bullying. Well, yeah.
Yeah.
I had one girl like throw gum in my hair. It was just like, mm-hmm. you think you all that? Like, it was a lot of that. And then on the flip side, it was a lot of leeches.
Mm-hmm.
So to this day, my relationships are very conditional because I still feel like a lot of people wanted to be associated with me based on who mm-hmm. I was connected to. Mm-hmm. So it was really hard to decipher who was authentic and who was just in it for the ride, because she was that mom, limos picking us up from school. Yeah, we had a stretch limo, honey.
Not
seventh
to pick
grade.
You up from school,
it
girl.
Did. It picked us up, and we went to T-Mobile and got my phone. Remember?
In a stretch,
the Escalade joint. I remember.
She got the details.
I got the details, honey. She did, but yeah, it was a culture shock for me because. To see your mom go from being depressed to being the superstar, it had a trickle effect on the whole family.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it did affect all of us in different ways.
The two of us, just you and me.
So how did you feel? So y'all did the duet on the second album, mm-hmm. The Two of Us, right? How did you feel when the album finally came out and you heard yourself on a record with your mom, and it's mm-hmm. people are buying the record and all that good stuff?
I was excited. Mm-hmm. I've always been a fan of my mom. Like, I couldn't really.
Girl, stop.
I am a fan of yours. First of all,
not true?
She don't think so.
We'll
dive into that.
Right. This is what she'll say sometimes, and she'll be mean it.
Mm.
That's why I don't like your music anyway.
We get into things for sure.
It's almost like I'm mom now. Don't mm-hmm. get it twisted, but sometimes we get into little mm-hmm. things.
It happens.
Yeah, but she hits below like the belt. Like she, it's okay.
I think
who she is.
You know, in therapy, I went through therapy and I had to learn how to express the void that I felt when she left. There was a lot of unanswered questions growing up and trying to navigate through being a young girl and trying to find my voice, and my mom's not there. That was hard to process. And then when I turned 16 is when she did the hiatus. Mm-hmm. So she came and got me and we moved to Atlanta, and it was hard. Mm-hmm. It was like, who is this woman? And what did you do with my mom? Like,
different person?
Oh, yeah. It was like living with a stranger. We had to learn each other again because she was gone for years just working. And on the flip side, I appreciate it because it helped us, you know, financially and all that stuff. But on the flip side, I hated her for a little while because I'm like, I didn't have my mom. You didn't come to see me play Miss Claus in fifth grade. I had a chip on my shoulder, but I think,
made sure she was straight.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? She don't understand the sacrifice. You know,
I do now.
Kids don't. Mm-hmm. But yeah. She didn't at the time.
Yeah.
I had to do this, so we would have been somewhere, you know.
And then showbiz is a whole nother act. Level of difficult. You're traveling.
Yeah.
And I think until she verbalized, like, you don't know I was on the road, what I was going through, and then I was missing you. You were my inspiration. And to hear her say that, it kind of like remedied all of the years of her absence being there. Because I knew my mom as I knew her wallet, but I didn't know her heart.
Ooh.
Wow.
So it, like, when I moved here, it was kind of like, give me this. And once I found out, like, oh, if I bribe her the right way or just get an attitude, she'll go buy me a Gucci bag. It was kind of like I was extorting her.
She did.
Yeah. And looking back, now that I got kids, it's like, she really just wanted to help me, you know? So I give her grace. We still have our spats. But
grace.
My perspective is different, for sure, now that I'm older.
There's definitely love. It's real.
Yeah. But the industry is hard. I always tell people, give celebrity kids grace, because whatever our parents are going through and whatever they're weathering, we're weathering it with them. Mm-hmm. And you have to give us grace, because y'all see tweet, but I have to deal with Charlene. And Charlene doesn't always want to deal with what comes with the industry. The industry hasn't been kind to Charlene, you know? And when Charlene is hurt, the whole family has to deal with that, because she's been the breadwinner for our family since 2000s. Yeah. My grandparents, my uncles, she takes care of everybody. Mm. So that grace was extended. Like, wow, like, it's still people that are depending on you to pay bills and do all this stuff. So now I'm like daughter bear. Like, all right, mom, that's enough.
You're protective.
Tell them no. I'm very protective, but then I think sometimes I could be her battleground too, where we're still trying to navigate through that, though.
So there's a lot to be proud of, though, in the growth of the relationship.
Oh, for sure.
Too.
Yeah. Because it was really heavy at one point where we couldn't even talk. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to explain my heart. Like, I did this so you can have. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. So we didn't have to live in the projects, or not there's nothing wrong with, you know, you know, but I did it, I sacrificed for you. Mm-hmm. And now for my grandkids, I do it for my grandkids.
Best grandma ever.
Best grandma
ever.
I love
my grandkids.
Yeah. I feel like what she couldn't do for me, she does for them 10 times more. Mm-hmm. So seeing her be a grandmother is healing the child in me, for sure.
Yeah. Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm proud of her. She's been through a lot. She hasn't said everything, but my mom has been through some dark things, and I think it changed my perspective on the industry, because how can somebody be a jewel? Southern Hummingbird age like fine wine. Yeah. Like, it's transcended time, generations. Yes. It's just a sound that is so classic. And just to see how the industry did her when the merge happened, we would have all types of celebrities call in the house. Those calls stopped. People that were her friends left her for dead. And to see her deal with that, it was just like, ew, these people are crazy. Yuck. And then a Phil Thornton comes around and like changes her life again. Right. So it's kind of, you know.
From your perspective, which people in this industry do you feel like have been awesome with your mother?
Phil, we could start there.
Thank you. Phil's nervous. He's like,
I'll take that and go
sit down. And just...
She doesn't have a lot of friends in the business. I can't say Pastor Tim Rogers has been really sweet to her. Selena Johnson, Mila is actually a good friend.
Yeah.
They toured Missy's album together. Mila's like an aunt. Uncle G, Genuine is really sweet to her.
That's my brother.
Yeah, that's a couple of people. That's Kelly Price has been sweet and pleasant every time we see her.
Mm-hmm.
Leandria Johnson, sweet. Yeah. A lot of church folk.
Yeah, I'm scared about that, though, because after I was dating someone.
A pastor.
Yeah, pastor. I thought the church, because they were very warm to me.
At that time?
Mm. Yeah, in that relationship.
The church really?
Was, no.
Mm. I'm saying like,
it was that's always actually looked surprising. Like,
what am I talking about?
What are you doing here? You know what I mean? It always felt like that. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And it was shocking though. I got to be, we don't have to say the pastor's name, but just seeing you with that pastor, I got to say, it was... I didn't see it coming.
No one did. I didn't think
that was another surprise.
That was a surprise for you too.
I didn't know it was going to go there like that. You know what I mean? Because I was focused on Charlene. I was really focused on doing the music. And it just happened like to be, you know, we just saw each other. We had been kind of DMing for years, like since years. But it wasn't no, what's up? It wasn't nothing. Hey, how you doing? You coming to my church? I would ghost him for a while. Then he'd be like, hey, I want you to come to my church. Okay, so we finally met. We saw each other. I finally saw him in Times Square. We had just did an interview for something at MTV, and we ran into each other, and we just started talking. And it just, I wasn't really ready for a relationship like that, but it just happened.
She's not happy over here.
Tell your truth then. Go ahead.
You weren't feeling that?
He turned my mom into a caravan.
What?
What?
I was not into that. All those swaddling clothes. It was a lot of fabric. The house, the closets in the house, fabric galore. Just
fabric.
It was just a lot of kitten heels. A lot of.
I didn't wear. I don't wear no kitten heels.
It was a lot. It was just a lot of
kitten heels. A lot of kitten heels.
It was a lot of.
So you didn't have no kitten heels.
It was a lot of Day of Pentecost going on. Azusa, honey. Yes.
So like first lady tweet.
First lady
Charlene. Was
I actually bought into it for a while because she was authentic in it, and I feel like she's a loyalist. When she commits to something, my mom is gonna ride. She rides for her friends and stuff. So I think when she went into that relationship, she went into it with full intentions to really love him, and she stewarded that relationship with grace. She left that relationship with grace because
if it was you, it would be different.
Huh. It would take every deacon. but that's not my story to tell. But she did handle it with grace. But it was I don't know. Yeah.
I mean, it is what it is. It happened.
Life.
I could have saw her as a first lady, though.
Life. Yeah.
Because she's churchy. My mom got the, chicken arm shout.
No, I don't.
Yeah. The chicken arm shout.
Yeah.
She said that. This is your shout right
she
now.
She real.
You know, these days, they skip.
Oh, yes, honey. You got to skip for Jesus.
That's a scoot back skip.
Yes.
We had to get in.
Elbows out.
That was a... We don't skip.
Yeah, she's churchy. Churchy.
Phil, have you ever shouted in church?
No.
Timon?
No.
I've not.
Chicken, we know.
Yeah. Scoop back. They, you know, the new generation, they
don't play
they
with
do
me.
That almost doing a heel toe.
Mine got a little chicken head to it.
You got a little chicken head.
It's a cute praise.
Have you ever shouted in church?
I have.
Wow. In my college days, you know, I'd have
to. Show me, what you did.
I'd have to.
Show some signs.
I grew up super strict Episcopal, but when I went to college, Stephanie, we all went to Kojic Church. And I was just like, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, y'all dancing in here? Cool, I can do that. Oh, y'all dancing in here? That's what's up. You got drums? Wow. Say less. And I was in. But then, we all have our church hurt, I feel like. I feel like we have our church hurt. And it's a weird place to be because you feel like there's so much that you love about church, the music.
Mm-hmm.
But then all the other, the politics and the...
Yes, I'd rather have a relationship with God where I don't have to go into a building to talk to him.
Mm.
Talk to him all the time. Because prayers is just a conversation with God.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So I don't need... I'm not against church or not like that. But I don't need to go there necessarily every Sunday to...
Every Sunday. In my kitten heels.
Yes.
You know, that's how I feel.
Yeah. Overall, at this point in your career, do you feel better understood? Do you still feel misunderstood?
Misunderstood and overlooked.
Mm. Misunderstood and overlooked.
Mm-hmm.
I second that. I feel like she's one of the most underrated artists. an underappreciated artist ever.
And it's okay though.
It's not.
Yeah, it is okay.
Put some respect on my mom's name.
Yeah, they do. People do. You know what I mean? Because my fan base, they are solid.
They're loyal.
They're loyal and solid. Mm. You know, but sometimes I do be looking at certain things like, oh, you didn't invite me? Oh, okay. You could have said my name on that one because a lot of these little young chicks right now, okay, I think they listened to that album. Okay.
Absolutely. Definitely.
Oh, yeah, for sure. About?
So
a lot of them. All of them.
Yeah.
So, you know, but it's okay.
I just feel like there's still so much she has to offer, but there's still a lot that she already gave the industry that people have either overlooked. I hate when people are like, where Tweet been? She been putting out music.
Yeah, she here.
There's Cruising. There's Love Tweet. That record, there are so many hidden gems on Love Tweet. Charlene is such a fire album. Yeah. It is such a classic, well put together album.
Yeah, what's your favorite song from your mom? You have a favorite?
It's a song called Football Love that never came out, that was supposed to be on It's Me Again. Mm-hmm. I love Best Friend, My Place. It wavers. It depends on like how I'm feeling. But yeah, Football Love is a fire record. I really want her to put that record out just to see what it
you
does.
You got too much unreleased stuff.
But yeah, the story behind it, she was dating a
football player.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you a tea. She was dating a New York Giant.
Oh.
And the reason why I say this is because my mom is so dope with her songwriting, like how she can really put real conversation, like how Taxi is. She literally talks about football
and, in the song.
Huh? Yeah.
It's all football related.
It's all football related and how like the backgrounds. Maybe she could play it when we get off.
Please do.
Y'all, this record, Iceberg is probably one of the top on my list. Just the guitars, the isms. It's just, I don't know how she puts stuff together. Another thing my mom does, I really wanted her to talk about this. One thing I learned from her, when she songwrites, on the top of the page, she writes the alphabet across the front of the, the top of
my
the...
Low. Yeah, it's like a not a ritual, because I'm not like that, but it's, I have to do that in order for my brain to work.
So you write
A, B, C, D,
all is at the top of the page,
yeah. Top
and
of the
then,
page,
you,
it
then
has
you can
to,
start writing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know what it is, but I do. But you can look at all my old songwriting books and you'll see it on there.
Every page. Mm-hmm. Every page. Wow. She literally has about, I would say, if she was to really sit down and mix and master every record that hasn't been released, she has at least 6 albums worth of music sitting.
Of
great quality, just
take my money now. Take my money now.
It's just beautiful, just well put together.
Well, that's what I'm doing when I'm leaving this week to go out to LA to start on some new stuff with Nissan, Craig and Charlie and Jubal. So we're about to get back in the lab.
Those my guys.
Get the whole team back together and crank out some more classics.
Time, and we're thinking about just listening to some of the stuff that we didn't release and kind of tweaking it and just
and
putting
it out.
Yeah.
Are you coming to Nashville anytime soon?
Because I'm saying, like,
there might be some people that want to collaborate that maybe in the role.
Listen, first of all, let's shout out Gabby real fast.
Yes. Gabby!
Gabby's hiding behind the cameras right now, but Gabby is the glue.
Yes.
G word of the day, glue. G word of the day is glue. Because she keeps everything, she was all stuck together. But we already told Gabby that when you come to Nashville, we want in.
Love to.
Badly.
For real?
Yes.
Let's do it.
Are you serious?
Very serious.
No, I'm ready. Whenever.
Is there a booth in the other room?
Let's go.
Gabby, she's here. Yeah. The glue has made it happen. It's already done.
Yeah.
The glue has made it happen. Yep. So Shenice, I got to ask you, because I know also you're an artist as well.
Sings her behind her.
Yes.
Incredibly talented.
Oh, thank you.
What would you say is the biggest lesson you've learned from your mom on your journey as a musician and artist?
That's a good question. Stay authentic to your story. And I think a lot of the records that I haven't put out, she wants me to put out, but they're super authentic. Mm-hmm. And I've seen my mom just remain graceful. So that's something that I'm trying to take away. My artistry, I think, for the longest, I had a chip on my shoulder to where it's like, I'm gonna do this without her. because I need to prove that I don't need to be tweet daughter from that hurt. You just, oh, you got this opportunity because you tweet daughter. Or it,
I want to avoid that.
Yeah, I want to silence that, but I didn't realize that it came off disrespectful to her because she's like, use me. I'm here to help you. I'm here to help you write. I'm here to help do whatever and help you navigate. So I think my pride is what kept me, is keeping me stagnant. But that's what I learned too. Just give into the music and keep it.
Yeah.
Because when we were recording It's Me Again, I mean, what is the song called? The Two of Us. I spent my summer with her, and I'll never forget it. Right. We were in Hit Factory, and my mom was in room C, Missy was in room A, and Brandy was recording Aphrodisiac in room
B. That's a lot going on at the Hit Factory.
It was a lot. And Whitney was there. Yeah. Bobby was there. Mm. It was just this whole just conundrum of just
hold on. Yet another building.
Exactly. Yeah.
That tweet is in. Tweet be in buildings. Tweet be in the number. Here we are in a building with Tweet, her brilliant daughter, Missy, Brandy.
Timbaland.
Whitney and Bobby just stopping by just to bring biscuits and play pool.
Just, me and Bobby Christine used to have sleepovers.
Yeah.
Just in the summertime?
Yes.
Yeah.
I was asleep.
You may not continue.
Yeah.
That was crazy.
I think I was asleep, and I woke up, and she was playing this bus stop record that ended up going to Jasmine Sullivan, and I started singing it. And she turned around like, what? And I was just running and just singing it, and she was like, wait a minute. Play that other track, and Uncle Craig started playing it, and she wrote it. I went back to sleep. I woke up, and she was like, get in the booth and sing it. And
just
I,
like that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. She kind of Joe Jackson me. No, Maddie Moss.
Maddie Moss. Definitely Maddie Moss, Jr.
Definitely Maddie Moss. It was like 3 o'clock in the morning, and to be a part of that with her is something that I hold true, because I feel like she believed in me, and me singing in that moment really showed her, okay, you ready.
I always knew, because Shauna was like 2 years old writing Baby Don't Leave Me. Like, she used to sing in the studio. And me and my group is like, what is she talking about? Yeah. And she had this heavy vibrato. Like, yeah, she gonna sing. Like, at two, nobody has a vibrato like that at two.
Yeah, 2 years old.
Yeah, I knew it. Yeah, that's what it is.
Will there be another duet?
Right.
Yeah. We have a gospel song that she hates.
Yeah, Devon Murphy, William Murphy's brother, produced this.
No, that's another one. I'm talking about the one I did with Juba playing on it.
Oh, yeah, that's beautiful. We have a few songs together, actually.
We're waiting.
Try releasing some.
We're waiting.
Yeah. Okay, we'll make it happen.
Yeah. I want you to stay here because I want you to hold your mom accountable as we play this, as we play Keep or Kill.
Oh, okay.
No.
I like games.
So, oh my gosh. Okay.
You know if your mom is telling the truth or not.
I'm going to call Cap.
Call Cap. Thank you. You know, Keep or Kill, we're going to call two people. One is the one you keep, another one's got to go for it.
Have to say?
Yeah.
Or can I?
Who you
want to
keep?
Who you
want to
keep?
Okay. Your keep is your favorite out of the two.
Yeah.
Okay.
No harm, no foul.
What if I don't want neither?
But you can say that.
That's even more keeping it real.
Okay.
Phil, set it off.
Earth, Wind & Fire or the Isley Brothers?
Oh, I got to keep both. Can I do both?
No.
No.
No?
No.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Oh, wow. Jeez. Oh, I'm going to keep the Isley Brothers. No, Earth, Wind, and Fire.
The Clark Sisters or the Pay Sisters?
Clark Sisters.
The Clarks.
Mm-hmm. PJ Morton or BJ the Chicago Kid?
BJ. Definitely BJ.
BJ?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
I mean, I love them both.
Yeah.
I love them both.
Michael Jackson or Prince?
We just had this conversation Thanksgiving dinner, my family did. Oh, Michael Jackson. I love Prince, though, but Michael Jackson.
Brandy or Jasmine Sullivan?
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh. That's nasty work right there. That's nasty.
That's so bad. Jasmine. Nope. Can I change it?
Yeah.
I'm going to say Brandy because Brandy inspired me in a whole lot of ways, you know? Singing when she first came out, I was like, who is this girl? Like, oh my God, you know?
Yeah.
I'm gonna say Brandy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Whitney or Mariah?
Whitney.
Whitney.
Aretha or Patty?
Aretha.
Aretha.
I love Patty though.
I did
Patty said she sung Oops one time in one of her shows.
What?
Yes, I saw her backstage somewhere. She was like, girl, I know who you are. I sung Oops one time in one of my shows. I was like, ah!
Who has the footage?
We gotta find that footage. Whoever has the footage of Patty LaBelle right. singing Oops at right. a show, please send that to me. Sound crazy because we need that for the archives.
Mighty Clouds of Joy, Gospel Keynotes.
Gospel Keynotes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Lettucey or Layla?
Ooh, y'all are rude.
It's rude.
Y'all are nasty. Oh my God, I love them both. Layla. Mm.
Jodeci or Boyz II Men?
Jodeci. I love Boyz II Men though, but Jodeci.
Timberland or Devontae?
Yikes.
Oh, wow. Devontae. I love Tim though, you know.
Keep or Kill Missy edition. Miss E, So Addictive or Under Construction?
So Addictive all day. Yeah, that's
fine. Agreed. That's my favorite album by her.
Really?
Yeah, there's just something about that album.
That one. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
SWV or Escape?
Ooh.
SWV.
Yeah. She thought she was Coco when I was little. All I heard was,
what?
Right.
Yeah. I played See, them all
she played
the time.
There. She thought she was Coco.
We,
you
know, sure we had SWV on here. We gave them their flowers, and we told Coco, them. All three of them, we told her how influential her voice is.
Mm-hmm. Oh, what?
I feel like every girl in the 90s, especially brown girl, wanted to be Coco.
100%.
She was in music, yeah, for sure.
It was Coco, for sure, and Mary J. Blige.
Mm-hmm. Coco and Mary J. Blige.
That's all she played.
I'm glad you said that, because Mary J. Blige or Faith Evans. Nice segue.
That's a doozy.
Oh, I love Faith. I'm going to say Mary.
Okay.
I'll say Faith again. Faith or Kelly Price?
Faith.
Ooh, that was tough.
I love them both, but yeah. Ooh, y'all wrong. Y'all so wrong.
90s R&B or 2000s R&B?
90s all day.
Okay.
Wait, 2000s had some stuff. We had Confessions.
But 90s.
Yeah, okay.
90s definitely had a special sauce.
Yeah, yes. It did.
To it.
Never Say Never or Full Moon.
Full Moon.
Full Moon.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Full Moon is nuts.
It's a classic, yeah. Yeah.
I'm spent.
Yeah.
Because
Keep or Kill Edition tweet, make some noise.
You came out of that alive.
I
Mom.
Did. That was hard, though.
We got one more hard question for you, though. Who is your Mount Rushmore?
Aretha. Okay.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
Aretha Franklin, Marvin Gaye, Al Green, the Clark Sisters. Can I do that?
Aretha Franklin.
Al Green.
Marvin Gaye.
The Clark Sisters.
That literally describes your sound.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah,
man. All a T. In a nutshell.
Let's deep fry.
Straight up. Yes. Deep fried and good as hell. Yes.
Ain't no baked over here.
That's what's up right there.
Uh-huh.
Ooh.
Is there anyone that you haven't worked with that you'd love to work with?
Ooh. Mm.
Really?
Literally.
Who do I always say I want to work with?
Alex Isley.
Yeah, I love her.
Ooh, that would be dope.
Absolutely love her.
That'd be awesome.
Loves Alex.
Oh, I play her all the time. Mm-hmm. Nobody really.
She's like, I'm good.
Yeah, I mean,
she actually has a song with BJ the Chicago
yeah,
Kid that
what
you guys have
on?
To hear. And it's fire.
Do you like R&B music right now?
Mm-mm. Huh.
No?
It's not R&B.
What's
That's
missing?
Not true R&B.
Is something missing or it just needs
music.
To be different?
The music is not really, it's like more poppy when we talk about R&B or it's a rap trying to be R&B.
Mm.
You know, so it's not that essence of you got a bridge, you got a dope chorus, you got vocals and you're talking about something from the soul. That's real soul R&B to me.
Yeah.
I don't hear that.
Brian Cox said in an interview that R&B was missing church. Do you agree?
That could be it, or soul. It's the soul is gone of it. you know?
The hard part I see also, and obviously it's a budget thing, it's a financial thing, mm-hmm. is that because hip hop is so, I'm gonna say it's easier to do,
mm-hmm.
and cheaper to do, mm-hmm. that you've lost all the budget for what R&B artists need to make their show
yes.
great.
Mm-hmm. Yes, mm-hmm.
So absolutely.
Talking about background, Stephanie and Suki and all them mm-hmm. from back in the day, mm-hmm. you still travel with your background singers.
Over
and
that's 20 years.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the first thing people want to cut. They want to cut the budget for the band and for the background singers, but you need all that to tell that whole mm-hmm.
musical yeah. story.
Yeah,
yeah. I got to have my girls. Like, even if I don't have the band, we going to kill. You
right,
know what I mean?
Right.
And you're going to get soul. You're going to get church. You're going to get soul. You're going to get R&B. You're going to get all of that in one with just me and the girls. So we can do a cappella too.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, no. But that's what that is.
It's missing.
The soul is missing.
Mm-hmm. The soul is missing. It's dry. It's real dry. Bland.
That's why we're waiting on your song.
No seasoning.
No seasoning.
How you going to have some powder
you to drop that.
Greens and you ain't got nothing in there?
I don't do right. so.
You ain't got that ham hock in there.
Oh, you ain't got nothing in there.
You just need some fresh blood in the game.
You just got water and greens.
Yeah.
That sounds terrible.
That's disgusting.
That sounds
That's
awful.
That's what it is. Mm-hmm.
But I feel you. I mean, I feel like there needs to be a. Looking forward to new music from you because there needs to be a reminder.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
As well of like what it takes, mm-hmm. what it should feel like.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
What it should sound like.
And I'm just gonna continue to do me. Like I haven't compromised, and that's my whole thing about the industry. They want you to.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted me to start dancing and wear leotards. That's not who I am. I look like a fool.
Mm.
You know what I mean? I'm not a dancer. They tried it on. Call me. I look dumb up there. You killed it. I don't dance. You know what I mean? I just want to sing. I play the guitar here. Yeah. Let me stay there. And that's what I'm going to do for this new stuff. I'm just going to continue to be tweet.
That's all we want from you.
Yeah. That's all I could be.
That's all we want.
Yeah.
Simply tweet.
Yeah. Simply tweet.
Finally tweet. Finally tweet.
Yes.
We never asked you this whole time. How did you get the name Tweet?
Right.
Oh, my dad wants to get credit. I've been Tweet my whole life. It's a nickname. It's not a stage name.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. I've been Tweet since I was 2.
Far before Twitter.
Yeah. Right. And my dad said he gave me the name. I don't know why. He don't remember. I'm thinking, because I used to climb. We used to have a piano. It's a picture. My head was huge. So maybe I had a huge head like Tweety Burger. And that's where it came from. I don't know. Yeah, my dad.
Oh, my goodness.
That's funny.
But I've been tweeting. That was a... Missy was like, what's your stage name going to be? And she made me think for like a day or two. It's like, I'm Tweet. I can't, like, what would it be? Chocolate brown? Like, right. What?
Chocolate brown.
No, I'm just Tweet. I just want to be Tweet.
Chocolate brown.
It's
brown could have worked.
It could have worked.
Can I ask her a question?
Yeah.
Oh, no. Then y'all can hire me. Y'all need a girl to be.
Oh, hey.
Yeah. Audition. There we go.
Okay. I want to know where the title of the album came from. Like, what made you name
Southern
Hummingbird? Yeah. Because I don't think I know.
Missy, when we finished the album, I was thinking of what it was. She was like, you sound like a Southern Hummingbird. And I'm thinking, that's quartet. I'm just going to name it Southern Hummingbird. You know what I mean?
So quartet.
Yeah, it is, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
it's like, that's so quartet. So, yeah, she always used to say, you sound like a Southern Hummingbird.
That's dope.
And I have to bear witness. I've seen my mom. I don't know if y'all feel. Were you ever part of any of her studio sessions?
No. I don't really go.
Seeing my mom in the studio is a whole nother experience of just greatness. Like, she records so quick. Like, she'll go in, hear a note, sing it, sing the other note, come out. Write the verse. She goes into the studio already with the songs written, pretty much.
Sometimes.
But I've never seen an artist record so quick and so, like, efficiently.
Mm-hmm.
It's, like, it's beautiful. I've seen her do maybe 5 songs within, like, a couple of hours.
It's, and you, for me, when I'm recording, I'm serious about my, what Erykah Badu say?
I'm serious about my shit.
Right.
You can't come in her session.
You can't. It's me and the engineer. That's it. Because I don't want nobody in the back. Girl, you should have sung it like this.
She kicks me out sometimes.
I don't want to do that. Mm-hmm. And maybe that comes from Devontae saying, don't be inspired by mm-hmm. you want your own sound. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I know what it sound like. Might be a little flat here, but I love those. Back in the day, some of those songs,
yeah, yeah.
they were singing on. Yeah. Yeah, the imperfections are my favorite.
Yes.
And I think that's one thing mm-hmm. that I can take away to answer Phil's question. Artist development is something that she stressed when yeah. I was growing up, and I seen her do it. So I come old school too, even though I'm young. Mm. I had to sit in signings and watch her sign every album and be at record stores. Like, I think that's what the industry is missing.
Yep.
Artists having to be developed versus just being, I love the rawness of being able to see somebody sing on Instagram, but a lot of people don't know how to translate that into artistry.
Right.
And if labels or whoever can implement development, I feel like we'll see a little bit more, you know, developed artists, because it's cringe sometimes seeing people. I think it's cringe for some artists and singers because they're comfortable singing on their phone and then you put them on a stage and there's it's like, what is going on? There was no time. She was developed.
You have to cut your teeth in a
we're
talking about a friend of the in a church.
Yeah,
where you have to earn your audience.
That too,
or a club,
you had to earn your keep.
That might have to be on. Yeah. You hear me?
Yeah,
you have to.
She didn't play with me. Media training. I went through media training. I don't use it much because I just. But she stressed being able to. If you're gonna do it, when
do
you get
it.
Out there,
right.
you're gonna do it. Don't be in here playing in the studio. If you can't sing it barely in the studio, that means you're not gonna be able to sing it live. So don't play with me. So I learned that too. She's always taught me, if you can't, you barely hitting a note behind the booth, and imagine, she's like, sing a song in the studio that you won't get tired of singing for 10, 12 years.
Absolutely.
So when I go and create music, I'm like, would I want to sing this when I'm 50?
Right.
And I think outside of Oops, my mom has created a lot of music that she can sing forever. That's why she's still booked. Mm-hmm. Like, she created music.
Don't
that,
sing now. When your mom's 80, she might still need.
Oh, she's still, I'm going to be pushing her in that wheelchair, sing it.
Earn your keep, sis.
She know you're gonna see it.
I'm not mad.
Oh, man. Wow, man.
I really have you. Would you ever consider doing reality television?
Yes.
We have a show called The Two of Us that I wrote up when I was in high school, and the whole synopsis, and we've been shopping it for years. But I think we would be perfect television.
Talk to Phil.
But it would be on my. I don't want.
Hey, Phil.
Like the reality TV that's now. I think I want to bring something that's different. Like, you know what I mean? Wholesome. Mm-hmm. And not only that, even in our. What we're going through, I want to show that.
I think
show
that's very powerful.
Oh, yeah.
Because
we're still actively going through it.
Like,
it's still,
you see it, that mothers and daughters don't get along. And it's because you just don't have the communication and stuff like that. And so I would want to help if I got to put my life out there. I would want to do it.
I think it's possible.
Has there ever been a reality show centered around a mother and daughter?
I think Regine and Toya they just launched theirs, and I was like, dang, we were supposed to do this years ago.
Regine. But y'all have something different because there's also like the music industry insight.
Yes.
Even like
there's so many layers.
So many layers.
Yeah. Beautiful layers.
And the things that you guys have overcome that a lot of people have not overcome in their mother daughter relationship.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like people that we know well. So there's a lot to share about what you've seen, what you've seen.
Yeah.
And even what you're saying back to us shows that you've been taught so well.
Oh, yeah. That's true. Her and Missy didn't play. I remember one time we were at a photo shoot, and Sylvia or somebody wanted to hear me sing. And me and my mom used to sing This Love by Mary and Fred Hammond. And she was snapping, and I came in on the wrong note. She was like, this is not the right note. She Maddie Moss me in front of Missy. The whole, I think it was Vibe magazine. All the executives was like, what? I was so ashamed. But now that kicks in. Like, girl, get it together. Yeah, I always hear her voice. But she was very
We got a little
adamant.
Maddie Moss spirit.
Oh, she does.
No, I don't.
You will see it even with her background singer. She'd be like,
you're
not mean,
together.
But they good. They good.
She got
a little Maddie Moss.
I see,
you see a little Maddie?
Yes, Steph, definitely don't play.
Yeah.
But like, I still see a little Maddie.
Yes, yes. And let that band like, not play
might.
Right. Oh, yeah.
Be able to say
yes.
Might.
Oh, she don't play. Especially with the music. It has to feel But it's not mean. She's just sensitive about her music, and she takes.
But you should, you should be. It should be about greatness. So which means that people can't be messing up. They gotta be gotta come correct.
Mm-hmm. Oh, she's gonna put on a show. I love watching her perform.
You know when you killed? You killed at the at Black Music Honors.
Yeah.
Oh,
really?
She did.
Yeah.
Nuts.
Thank you.
Outfit crazy, vocal. Ooh, that whole
swag
thing was nuts.
Crazy.
Swag was nuts.
Have you ever heard her perform "My Man"? Her song "My Man." God.
I don't think so.
Ugh. I'll show y'all some videos.
No,
we'll talk.
We'll talk off camera. So what? So what's the plan for the next year? I've heard some rumblings of more touring, different kinds of touring. What's that looking like?
Definitely touring, and I'm also doing a sitcom.
Yeah.
Let me sit up.
Yeah.
A sitcom, you say?
Yeah. It's with Shar Jackson, but it's about two friends.
Okay.
I go away to college, and I become this person that has a lot of shops. And I come back home to open one there, and me and my best friend, she's like my best friend. So, yeah, I'm excited about that.
Yes, actor.
I'm excited about that.
Actress.
Yeah, because I really want to, like, I don't want to perform for the rest of my life.
You don't?
No.
Okay.
No. I'll write. But I don't want to be, like y'all was just saying, I don't want to be 80 singing Oops.
Tell you what I did last night.
I mean, not that I'm so grateful, Lord, I am. But no, that stage and the preparation and the anxiety before going on stage, that was wear and tear on your heart, your mind, your body. Yeah. You know what I mean? Mm. I want to go sit down and chill with my grandkids. Yeah. You know what I mean? But y'all still get music and stuff.
We need the music.
Yeah,
we need
it. Or just let us in the vault. I know it's like, you know,
let us in the vault.
It's a whole bunch of bunch of music there.
It is.
And really more touring next year as well.
Oh yeah, so touring, doing that, and new music for sure.
Well, we cannot wait.
Yeah. I can't wait. I'm excited.
The Esther Roll
Award.
I can feel him moving. I can feel him moving on the altar of my heart. Every now and then.
Well, before we wrap, we do this thing called the Esther Roll.
Oh my God.
Black Excellence Award. Mm-hmm. The Irby.
Uh-huh.
So, do you know that Esther Roll has had a gospel album called Garden of My Mind?
No.
Timon will send you the vinyl.
I'm actually looking for the vinyl.
Timon will send you the vinyl, but it's real.
Are you serious?
It came out as a voice.
It's
real.
And it's good. And it's really good.
It's good.
Oh, really?
So, yeah. Timon's playing it for us, and we're like, yo, what's that? He's like, being up on this kid is that it's that new Esther Roll.
Oh my God.
So got us to talking about basically how like there's so many things that black entertainers do that don't get the love or shine that it deserves. That's what the award is based off of.
Okay.
So we named it the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award. Every week we nominate, all of us nominate someone, you're included by the way, to who we think should be celebrated for their talent. Doesn't always get the love.
Okay.
And then we vote.
Okay.
Well, I'm just going to take a sip of my tea.
Go ahead and take a sip.
It's an easy one this week.
Yep.
Yeah,
It's easy. Singer, songwriter, actress.
Producer.
Actress.
Just all around boss.
Southern Hummingbird.
The creator of this piece right here.
Oh, my God.
It's Charlene Tweekey.
Yes.
Absolutely.
For real.
Unanimous. Yes.
Is that girl unanimous?
It's unanimous.
It's unanimous.
Congratulations, Tweet. You are the recipient of the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award this week. You want to give us a few words?
No, I'm just kidding. I appreciate it so much. I'm not used to even getting acknowledged. And for you guys to even think of me is amazing. And I'm grateful and honored. Thank
we
you.
We love you, Tweet.
Thank
we
you.
Love you. The love from Tweet is real.
It's
real. Wow, this thank podcast. You. And I appreciate
straight
it.
Yes.
It
yeah. And we thank you for the hard work. It's recognized. Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that. Thank you.
For real grateful.
Thanks.
I'm going to ride around the city tonight.
He's like, Siri,
put on Southern Hummingbird.
Oh wow.
Whenever you want to come back, you're welcome at We Sound Crazy.
For sure.
Whenever you want to come back,
right. You're welcome. Come on, guest co-host.
And Will. Seriously, y'all are a good time.
Thank you.
We're coming to the show. We're supporting. Let us know. Yay. Gabby will let us know too. But let us know everything that's happening so we can make sure we show. Yes,
absolutely.
Love.
Yes, thank you.
In all the ways.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Shout out Gabby.
Yay.
What up, Gab?
Yes. Happy birthday, Gabby.
Happy birthday, Gabby.
Before we leave, we always allow our special guests to choose the song that the episode goes out on. And it can be the song that's on your heart or the one that you feel like best sums up our conversation.
But while you're thinking about that, just telling everybody, make sure you check us out on all platforms.
Very much.
At We Sound Crazy and WeSoundCrazy.com. Chuck Harmony's OnlyFans page is back up. Yeah. So make sure you check that out. And I believe the Black Planet is up as well. But, special shout out to our friends at Visit Music City. Thank you for your continued support.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God.
Not OnlyFans.
Yeah, it's the foot model. It's the foot model.
What song are you playing a lot right now?
I'm playing Lisa Knowles and the Brown
Singers. Yes, sir.
I'm killing that album right now.
Give us a song.
Right on time.
That whole project.
Oh yes. My God. Mm. That album is everything. Okay.
So we're going to go out with some soul stirring. Tweet, thank you so much.
Yeah,
thank you,
Tweet. Thanks for having me. Thank y'all. Yay. Woo. Woo. Yay.
I just love to call it.